We want to let the world know that these words describe what we mean and what we are determined to do about racial injustice. One is the word all. We don't want some of our rights. We don't want a few token handouts here and there. We want all of our rights. The other word is here. There are some people who say that we need to go back to Africa. And then there are some others who tell Negroes in the South to leave the South. You can't be free, so get out. But down in Alabama and Mississippi and Georgia and South Carolina, we are saying something else now. We want all of our rights, and we want all of our rights here in Alabama and Mississippi and South Carolina. And then there's a third word. It is the word now. We are not willing to wait 100 years for our rights. We are not willing to wait 50 years for what is ours on the basis of the Constitution of this United States and the authority of God Himself. No, we are not willing to wait another 25 years for our rights. We can hear voices telling us to slow up. We can hear voices telling us to cool off. Our only answer in calm, patient terms must be that we have cooled off too long, and if we keep cooling off, we'll end up in a deep freeze. We must go on and say, no, what we are saying to this nation is that we want all of our rights. We want them here, and we want all of them not next year, not next week. But we want them now, at this hour. This is what you're saying.
Good afternoon, Suffield, and welcome to our annual commemoration of Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr. Thank you for tuning in today. It's obviously been a year since we last got together to celebrate the life and legacy of Dr. King. And what a year it has been. The world has changed and shifted in ways I never could have imagined. It's almost like a magical shapeshifter going from one thing to the next, month after month after month. The world is no longer the way it used to be. Here in the United States alone, we've lost countless lives to COVID-19, police brutality, systemic racism, and white supremacy in its many forms. As we know from the beloved song, Seasons of Love from Rent, there are, and you can sing it with me, 525,600 minutes in a year. The song asks the question of the audience, how do you measure the life of a woman or a man? In daylights, in sunsets, at midnights or cups of coffee, in the truths they learned or in times they cried, in bridges burned or the way they died. It's now time to sing out, though the story never ends. Let's celebrate, remember, a year in a life of friends. Today, I'm not only celebrating Dr. King, but I'm celebrating all people of color, particularly our students. Dr. King paved the way for them to be here, for them to speak their truths, for them to share what their life has been like over this past year. They've turned pain into beauty through art and reflection. They've poured their souls into movements for a better and brighter tomorrow. They've spent countless hours laboring over the pain and suffering of our people and educating others about the importance of anti-racism work and inclusivity. In the next few moments, you'll hear and see the work, the pain, and joy from some of our students. On this platform made possible to all of us because of the civil rights movement and every soul who protested, motivated, marched, and preached to make America better for everyone. So without further ado, I give you a small portion of our amazing affinity group, Students of Color United at Suffield Academy.
My name is Reagan Russell, and I'm a four-year senior from Nassau, Bahamas. On a trip to Barnes & Noble with my brother last month, he picked out a book for me called I'm Still Here. The book, written by Austin Channing Brown, discusses the struggle of Black people, Black women in particular, as we cultivate dignity in a world made for whiteness. I'm going to read to you one of the passages from the book that stood out to me the most. It discusses a topic that is especially informative on a campus such as ours, the truth that kindness does not negate the presence of racism. Most white people still believe that they are good and that the true racists are easy to spot. I don't know where this belief comes from, but I do know it has consequences. When you believe niceness disapproves the presence of racism, it's easy to start believing bigotry is rare, and that the label racist should be applied only to mean-spirited, intentional acts of discrimination. The problem with this framework, besides being a gross misunderstanding of how racism operates in systems and structures enabled by nice people, is that it obligates me to be nice in return, rather than truthful. I am expected to come closer to the racist, be nicer to them, to coddle them. After MLK Day, this chapel, and the upcoming Black History Month, I challenge you to identify instances where kindness is mistaken for anti-racism. Once you identify these instances, use your voice to educate and hold people accountable. Thank you.
Hey, what's going on? It's Elijah Lovelace, class of 2022 here at Suffield, and today I'll be talking about my experience here as a Black man. My time at Suffield has been a very great experience. I've had many ups and downs I've had to face, especially coming from a junior boarding school where it's predominantly white. Coming from that school, it helped me realize what it's like being an African-American man in today's society. It showed me that I have to work for everything I want. In today's world, we face many challenges, coming from white privilege all the way to African-American privilege that we have. This could be defined by what recently happened at the Capitol. This all connects back to Black survival at the end of the day, where there's a lot of challenges that our people have to face, but that doesn't stop us. With everything going on in today's society, I feel like it helped shape me into the man I am and being able to learn how to face those challenges. I'm at a school right now that really supports me and helps me, but sometimes racism can go under the table and be unnoticed. At Suffield, we have a great community that helps us with that, and it really brings out the Black community. At my old school, there was a maximum of like 10 people there that were Black, and here is a good amount of people that are Black of color. I feel like at Suffield, it's easy for us to voice our opinions, but at the same time, there's people that don't speak up that should be speaking up, like me. But we can always do a better job at helping the person next to us, no matter the skin color or the race. So let's do all of ourselves a favor and work together as a community and better ourselves. Thank you.
Dear Donald Trump, every day as a Black girl growing up in America, I'm forced to wear my identity when I step into any room. I'm consistently scared for my people, for my family, for my brother. I'm tired of the lack of value and worth tied to my life and my brothers and sisters. I feel helpless as I live in a world that fights day and night to repress my light and my rights. Why do I have to scream in their faces about my value, about my rights as a human being, about why I should be given a chance, about why I don't deserve to be stomped down and dragged in the streets, and why I don't deserve to be brutalized, about why I don't deserve to be massacred brutally like an animal, about why it is important to make a change, about why I'm screaming at the top of my lungs to be valued, to be seen, and to be heard. At a young age, I was forced to accept the brutalities of this world and its unapologetic nature that works to confine me. I'm forced to live in a world which has proven time and time again that I'm not wanted on this earth. Your open invitation for bigotry and blatant racism for the past 4 years has made my high school experience very interesting, along with other students of color across the nation. Your insistent need to spew your nonsense has made children across this nation feel unsafe in learning environments. Your slogan of Make America Great Again and red hats are now signals of danger for people of color all over the country. Your ability to not condemn white supremacy has opened the doors for covert racism that has been hidden for so long. You have emboldened those who are threatened by our very existence and wish to disrespect and dehumanize our lives. The scariest part is, despite the countless disgusting remarks and events and conversations you have fueled, it does not come as a surprise. I think about this past summer, when myself along with so many others stood up bravely for Black lives and marched and protested to incite some change. We were labeled as thugs and vandals. You do not get to characterize our anger, hurt, and our trauma. Your hypocrisy astounds me. You are a symbol of white supremacy in this nation, and I refuse to let your influence have power over my future. Bigotry and ignorance will never win. You will not be missed. Sincerely, all those who no longer remain prisoner to your idiocracy.
They will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream.
Why is a Black life any more recoupable than a white life? You know?
We are oppressed. We are exploited. We are downtrodden. We are denied not only civil rights, but even human rights. So the only way we're going to get some of this oppression and exploitation away from us or aside from us is come together against a common enemy.
We just want to party.
Slipping up, look what I'm whipping up. This is America. Don't catch you slipping up. Don't catch you slipping up. Look what I'm whipping up. This is America. Don't catch you slipping up. Look how I'm living up. Police be tripping up. Yeah, this is America. Guns in my area. I got the strap. I gotta carry 'em. Yeah, yeah, I'ma go into this. Yeah, yeah, this is gorilla. Yeah, yeah, I'ma go get the bag. Yeah, yeah, or I'ma get the pad. Yeah, yeah, I'm so cold like, yeah. Yeah, I'm so dull like, yeah. We gon' blow like, yeah.
Straight to the root that people oftentimes think we are dealing in hate.
No justice!
No peace!
No justice!
No peace!
No racism!
Police!
No justice!
No peace!
Black empowerment to me is uplifting all things Black, supporting all things Black, being proud to be Black, and using your platform and your voice in support of all things Black. It's supporting black businesses. It's supporting black artists. It's taking time out to educate your friends and family on all things black if you're not black. And it's just about spreading love all the way around.
Lee got M's in the bank like yes indeed. Cartier glasses, I won't even peek at you. Yellow Ferrari like Pikachu. I got him waiting and watching what he gon' do. Tryna pee what I do, tryna steal my moves. 2500 for a new pair of tennis shoes. The same price I can make them youngins come and finish you. Lawyer being charged, he a jewelry like a voodoo. Real dope boy, 100,000 in his visa. President's attention, slide by, we don't see you. I been getting money, I ain't worried about what he do. I'm getting money like a...
Dwelling in Ignorance by Chastity Bland. Does my history bore you? Is the mirror in the bathroom more enlightening than the red lining in the United States of America? Is the feeling of leaving the poor projector talking about basic human rights give you a thrill, or does it slowly kill your sensitivity to oppression? I know you're the person that America was made for, but did you ever stop and think who is really at the core? Who slaved for the foundation? Who made and still makes the nation? Who is the example for how all of Gen Z should talk? Who worked in the sun for hours so that your ancestors could make money, pass it on, and let you come to class with your camera off and the clothes you slept with on? Disregarding the will to gain knowledge, does it hurt to try and understand why black people are deemed thugs and lawless? Ignorance is a deep hole that only you can pull yourself out of. It is your duty to learn, to sympathize, to listen, to fight, but you wallow like a kite. Dwell in the sea of ignorance and choose to ride its waves, while the rest of the people are on the beach cleaning the trash from the grains of sand. Don't be the surfer riding the waves. Come to the shore and clean the beach before you get wiped out by a 50-foot wave and will never be able to go back and pick up the plastic pack and make a real impact. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Cassie DuMay, and I'm a 4-year senior day student from East Long Meadow, Massachusetts. One way that I express and process my experience as a young black woman in America is through my studio art.
One of my first original pieces as a studio artist at Suffield Academy is this piece I named Turning Towards the Color of the Sun. When I was creating it my sophomore year, I wanted to create an artwork that other black women and black people could see and feel proud of. I wanted to create a positive, beautiful representation of blackness, and I think I accomplished that. The second piece I want to show you today is actually half of a project that I planned. The project was meant to be a double portrait. One portrait of the man you see in a prison uniform, and the second an enslaved man. The project was supposed to represent the parallels I see between the modern prison system and chattel slavery. However, I had to stop halfway through the project because it was genuinely emotionally draining. As easy as it is to view me and my peers as strong, young black women and men, and not worry yourselves about the extra burdens that we face, we're teenagers dealing with trauma, and we're trying our best given the circumstances.
After the events of this summer, when the countless lives taken unjustly by the police came to the forefront of our national dialogue, studio art helped me process my feelings and frustrations. Expressing myself through studio art helped me communicate my anger without being misconstrued as aggressive or dangerous in a country that constantly nitpicks the way black Americans express ourselves.
Our chapel began today with a video of Dr. King and excerpts of his words. I want to remind us that his words have never been truer. We want to let the world know that these words describe what we mean and what we are determined to do about racial injustice. You heard from some of our students. You heard their agony, their pain, their desire. This moment is not fleeting. This moment is real. This moment is truth, and this moment is hard. And together, we will press on. Dr. King went on to talk about three words: all, here, and now. We want all of our rights, not just a mere few. We want our rights here. When he spoke this, he was referring to the South, Alabama, Mississippi, and in the Carolinas, but it traveled north, east, and west. Racial discrimination was not limited only to the South. And his third word, now, we want these rights, all of them, right here, right now. Not tomorrow, not in a week or in a year, but now. Dr. King made these speeches and pleas over 50 years ago, and we're still asking for equality. How many more lives need to be lost? How much more oppression can one group of people take? Whether it's the Black and Brown community, the LGBTQ plus community, the Muslim community, and all other marginalized and vulnerable identities. We're not willing to wait 50 more years. He joked that if we go and cool off, we'll end up in a deep freeze. Now, I don't know about your household, but in mine, when I put things that I want to go into a deep freeze, they end up freezer burned, shriveled up, dried, and unusable. Don't let yourself get into a deep freeze for unity. Don't let yourself become unusable. But rather, identify what you're willing to light that flame, ignite that passion and fire driven inside of you. For together, we can be better. We all matter together. It is my hope and my desire that as we wrestle through these thoughts and ideas and educate ourselves, whether it's with a group of people or individually, that we really work to take a look and take a deep dive reflection of who we are, of our morals, and of our values. What we hope to leave behind for future generations and what we hope our present generation will learn from us, and what we wish to see change in ourselves. Because if we want to see change in the world, we must first look within and see the change in ourselves. If you want tomorrow to be better and brighter, we have to be brighter and better. If we were in our usual chapel meeting space, I would be looking out on a sea of students, faculty, and staff, a vast variety of beautiful people with beautiful differences who can learn from each other, from their differences, and celebrate and praise each and every one of them, not try to hide them. That's what Dr. King would have wanted. That's what we all want, isn't it? After our commemoration program is finished today, I ask that maybe you hit the replay button and listen to the voices of our students. See their photos, see their beauty, and their pain. Our march will continue on, but we're pleased to have so many of you by our side. Thank you.